Hey bees, I'm Marie from Humble Bee and Me, and today I am tackling some of the questions that I got about the super simple all natural lotion formulation that I shared earlier this month. If you haven't watched the video and read the partner blog post for my super simple all natural lotion formulation, I really recommend checking that out before diving into this follow-up Q&A video, because just everything will make a lot more sense. The first question we are tackling is about adding essential oils or fragrance oils. You know, when should you do it and how should you do it? Essential oils and fragrance oils are heat sensitive, which means that we want to add them in the cool down phase, which in this formulation means that we would be adding them at the same time we would add the preservative. From there, we would then carry on with testing the pH and adjusting if required. Adding a small percentage of essential oils to your formulation won't meaningfully impact the pH of the formulation, and remember that essential oils do not have a pH of their own as they aren't water soluble. You'll make room for essential or fragrance oils in your formulation by reducing the amount of distilled water. So if you were going to add half a percentage of an essential oil blend or a fragrance oil, you would knock half a percent off the quantity of distilled water in the formulation and then add that half a percent to the cool down phase, and that keeps the entire formulation in balance, so it still adds up to 100%. Whenever you are adding essential oils to your formulations, make sure you are following the specific to the essential oil maximum usage levels. There's quite a lot to learn and a lot more nuance to working with essential oils and skincare than you might think. I learned how to calculate sensitizers and maximum usage levels through my Formula Botanica Diploma in Organic Skincare Formulation. So they are currently offering a free masterclass right now. So if you want to check that out, I will throw a link to that so you can sign up for that, and also a link to my review for my diploma in organic skincare formulation if you want to learn more. Because if you do want to formulate with essential oils and you are hoping to sell to the public, it is so important that you understand how to do it safely. Our next question is, can I add some powdered goat milk to the formulation? And for this one, the answer is going to be a kind of try it and see how it works. Our major concern here is the stability of the milk in the formulation, as milk, you know, it's not known for being a super shelf stable thing. You know, that's why we don't really store it on like our countertops. When looking to formulate with an ingredient that perhaps you haven't formulated with much before, or you're looking to formulate with it in a new way, a very helpful way to get an idea for what can work is to look for sample formulations that use that ingredient from suppliers and manufacturers. Lotion Crafter has a formulation for a goat milk lotion that they note has passed preservative testing, and so that is a really useful kind of reference, and so I'll refer to that kind of as we carry along, and that is linked in the partner blog post. The formulation from Lotion Crafter uses 1% of a goat milk powder, and they note that that is equivalent to 9% goat milk in the finished formulation, and so I would consider that to be a pretty good place to start, since we are concerned about goat milk potentially making this a harder to preserve formulation. Keeping the amount of that harder to preserve ingredient on the lower side is a good place to start. To incorporate that 1%, you would want to reduce the amount of distilled water by 1% and then add 1% goat milk powder. You might also want to modify the formulation to include a chelator to further boost the performance of our preservative. For this question, I really recommend reading that partner blog post as well, which is always linked in the description box below my videos. I have linked to a two-part blog series that I did not write about formulating for really shelf-stable cosmetics. It talks about a lot of different categories and strategies. So you might, if you make this kind of as is with just swapping in that 1% goat milk lotion or goat milk powder and find that it's not as stable as you know, we're hoping it goes moldy or gross on you, then you can kind of go back and think, all right, well, what are some other strategies that I could implement in this formulation to improve its stability and to boost the performance of my preservative? Our third question is about using different preservatives than the preservative I used. So the preservative I used is called GeoGuard ECT. I had one person asking if they could use phenoxyethanol instead due to availability challenges, and another person asking if they could use GeoGuard Ultra instead of GeoGuard ECT, because GeoGuard ECT smells like almonds and that might not be a thing that you love. Using a different preservative than a formulation calls for is always a bit of a, it depends, you know, do some research, make it and see. I've written an entire FAQ on this, so that is also linked in the partner blog post and it is worth reading. But for the context of this particular formulation, there are a few things that you would want to keep in mind. The first is that our emulsifier is anionic, it's negatively charged. So if you are researching your preservative and it says it doesn't work with anionic formulations, you would either need to change the preservative you're looking at using or change the emulsifier. The emulsifier in this formulation, Redemulse SCG, also doesn't work if the pH of the formulation gets too low. And I made this happen by initially trying this formulation using GeoGuard Ultra. GeoGuard Ultra is water soluble, but it takes a while. So I like to include it in the heated water phase so that the heat just helps it dissolve faster. Unfortunately, it made the pH of the water phase so low that the emulsion completely failed. It didn't form at all. Knowing that I wanted this to be a super simple formulation, I decided to pivot and use GeoGuard ECT because we could add that in the cool down phase, and even without any L-arginine in the formulation, it didn't cause the formulation to split. For super simple formulation, I really didn't want to put a new formulator, somebody who's new to making lotions, in a situation where their emulsion could fail right off the bat because the preservative made the whole formulation too acidic. So that's why I didn't use GeoGuard Ultra. I'm sure you could get it to work, but that is a thing that you will have to keep in mind, is that I believe I used it at 1.5%, and yeah, it didn't work at all. And then the last thing to keep in mind is that, as written, this formulation is pretty simple. It doesn't contain a lot of ingredients that would really challenge the performance of a preservative. I don't have a lot of experience using phenoxyethanol as the sole preservative in a formulation, but it was one of the preservatives that I tested in the year-long preservative test that I did as a patron exclusive. So if you are interested in checking out that test, that experiment, it is available as a series of patron exclusive videos over on my Patreon at patreon.com/MarieRaima. The lotion formulation that I used to test all the different preservatives in that experiment was slightly more challenging to preserve formulation than this one, and the phenoxyethanol did just fine. So with that knowledge and experience, I would think that you'd probably have pretty good experience with phenoxyethanol as your sole preservative in this formulation. But as always, make sure you are following good manufacturing practices and, you know, keep an eye on it. And of course, there are more links, more recommended reading in that partner blog post to refer to. A very good FAQ to read in the context of this question is, how do I know if my preservative is working? Question number 5 is about pH and which ingredients will impact the pH of your formulation. And for this, I've got a food metaphor for you. So think of pH as flavor. So, you know, all of the ingredients that go into a dish are going to play some sort of role in how the final dish tastes, but some ingredients are a lot more potent than others and will have a much, you know, a much bigger impact on the flavor of the finished tasty thing at smaller amounts. So something like spices, like ground cumin or cayenne pepper, is going to impact the flavor of a dish a whole lot more than something like a carrot or some broth. In formulating, the more extreme the pH of the ingredient and the more of it you use, the more likely it is to have a noticeable impact on the pH of your finished formulation. Water-soluble ingredients that are really basic or really acidic, so I would say that for really basic, we'd be looking at a pH of 9, 10 or higher, and for really acidic, it would be kind of like 3, 4 or lower. Those are going to be the ingredients where you're going to be expecting those to have an impact on the pH of your overall formulation, and you will need to consider that as a formulator. Some examples of acidic ingredients that will really shift the pH of your formulations include citric acid, lactic acid, ascorbic acid, also known as vitamin C, and some of the natural preservatives that we've been talking about in this video, GeoGuard Ultra and GeoGuard ECT. And then on the basic side, of course, L-arginine, which we use to raise the pH of this formulation, sodium hydroxide, glucoside, potassium hydroxide, and some surfactants like decoglucoside and cocoglucoside are really quite basic. So when I am formulating with a surfactant like decoglucoside or cocoglucoside, I will typically include something quite acidic right off the bat to lower the formulation's pH. So that could be including a small amount of citric acid, or in the case of the super simple foaming hand wash that I shared in the spring, I chose a natural preservative, GeoGuard Ultra, and used its acidity to, you know, bring the pH of the formulation down. And our last question is about incorporating anti-aging ingredients into this formulation. You know, can you? And this one does end up being another great big it depends, because there are so many different ingredients that could be classified as anti-aging ingredients. For the purposes of this answer, I'm going to start referring to them as actives. You'll need to begin by researching the active ingredient that you want to include in the formulation to learn about what it needs to succeed, what it needs to thrive, what it needs to be happy. And a great place to start that research is in the Humble Bee and Me DIY Encyclopedia. I really try to include every little bit of information that you would need about an ingredient to work with it in a formulation. I also have an FAQ titled, How Can I Incorporate X being just like a variable ingredient into my formulation? And so I recommend giving that a read as well. It's got a list of questions to get answers for. And so we're gonna work through those questions in relation to this formulation. Thing one to consider is, what is the active soluble in? Now, this lotion has an oil phase and a water phase, so you can include oil-soluble and water-soluble actives because they will have a suitable solvent. Thing two to consider is the recommended usage rate. That's how you know how much of the ingredient to put in the formulation for it to have an effect, for it to do the thing that you want it to do. So you can check the Humble Bee and Me Encyclopedia for this information, and your supplier should also provide it. I generally recommend starting in the middle of the recommended range. So if it's like 2 to 5%, I'd probably start with like 3.5%, unless the ingredient is really expensive, in which case I would start kind of around the bottom of that recommended range. The third point to consider is heat sensitivity. If the ingredient is heat sensitive, it'll need to go into the cool down phase. And if it is not heat sensitive, then you can put it in a heated phase. You don't necessarily have to put the ingredient in its matching heated phase. So for example, when I'm working with an ingredient like xanthan gum or hydroxyethyl cellulose or colloidal oatmeal, these are all water-soluble ingredients, but I usually prefer to put them in the heated oil phase because they tend to kind of thicken and clump and glop up in the heated water phase, and it makes the heated water phase kind of just less lovely to deal with. So if I put them in the heated oil phase, they won't clump, but they will disperse, and then they will dissolve into the water phase once the two phases are combined and then, like, you know, blended together. If the ingredient needs to go into the cool down phase, keep in mind the overall size of your cool down phase, because that is a limiting factor when making an emulsion. You typically don't want your cool down phase to be bigger than 10%, because that can cause emulsion stability. And so if you already have, you know, like 8% ingredients in your cool down phase, you might kind of start thinking, well, maybe this isn't the place to put this active, or maybe you need to reduce some of the other ingredients in your cool down phase, or use less of the active so that you're keeping that cool down phase small enough that it's not going to cause your emulsion to go all blah on you. The fourth point to consider is the pH of the ingredients. We touched on this a little bit earlier, but say you were looking to include an ingredient that's very basic or very acidic, that is going to impact the pH of the formulation. So say you want to include something very basic. Maybe you no longer need to include the L-arginine in the formulation. Maybe that basic ingredient can do the job of the L-arginine. But if the active that you want to include is quite acidic, you may need to use more L-arginine to counter that out. The fifth thing to consider is, does the ingredient need a specific pH range to work? Now, the pH of the ingredient and the pH range that it needs to be happy are not necessarily the same thing. Remember that the pH for this formulation, as written, comes out to about 5 to 5.5, and that works for our emulsifier and for our preservative. Does the active you want to use, is it happy in that range? Or does it need something dramatically different? Does it need a pH range that is dramatically different enough that you may need to consider a different preservative or a different emulsifier. If that's the case and you're looking at changing the preservative and or the emulsifier, you are starting to get into kind of a bit of reformulation territory. The sixth point to consider is the charge of the active. Remember that our emulsifier is anionic, negatively charged, so you would want to tread carefully if the active that you wanted to incorporate is cationic or positively charged. And then our seventh point is, you know, does the documentation have any sort of explicit no-nos in it? Does it explicitly say, like, don't mix this active ingredient with something that is present in this formulation? Because if it does, then you should be, you know, reformulating to make sure that the problematic interaction can't happen, or choosing a different active. You'll also want to make sure that the active doesn't have any other, you know, really specific needs that have to be accommodated, and then also looking at if it has any characteristics that might be challenging to the formulation, like it being very high in electrolytes. Once you've done your research and kind of run through all of that and you're not seeing any big, like, head-butting red flag sort of things, then it's time to just do it. You know how much to use and you know which phase to include it in. And so you will be, you know, adjusting the amount of distilled water to make room for the thing, for the new fancy active ingredient. Make a batch, keep it small. I'd probably say 50 grams, maybe 100, depends on how expensive the active ingredient that you are incorporating is. Take lots of notes, keep an eye on it, see what you think, and yeah, you did it. You added some anti-aging ingredients to your formulation. And a bit of a word of warning on working with actives. It can be really, really tempting to put in all the actives into a formulation. Perhaps you've bought a bunch of different ingredients that are all supposed to help with, you know, anti-aging or with acne, and you figure, well, you know, if one is good, then all of them is better. And this isn't necessarily the case. I really recommend that you get to know your ingredients on a one-on-one basis, because it could be that, say you've put in like four active ingredients in a formulation, it could be that like ingredient number one would have been super helpful if ingredient number three hadn't been there, but ingredient number three is like making your skin angry, and so you can't tell that ingredient number one is really, you know, could have been really helpful. Or it could be that ingredients like two and four would have been an absolute magic combination for your skin just on their own, and that like ingredients one and three were completely unnecessary. So yeah, it's a good idea to just get to know your active ingredients, especially your expensive active ingredients, on a one-on-one basis before you start making really complex and really expensive formulations. All right, so that has been our all natural, super simple lotion follow-up Q&A. If you have any other questions about lotion making, I have linked to a bunch of helpful resources in that partner blog post. Last year I did a video, like five common questions I get asked about lotion, and answered them all there. So questions like making lotions thicker and thinner, about using hydrosols instead of water. There's a bunch of questions that I get a lot answered in that video, so that's definitely worth checking out too. Thank you so much for watching. Please read the partner blog post and have an awesome lotion-y day. Bye.